There's a show out there on television now. Some of you may have seen it. It's called The First 48. And I find it quite interesting. Anyone ever seen that show, The First 48? Okay, so we do got some TV watching fans. But anyway, there's a show called The First 48, and it's a very interesting show. There's some dynamics about the show that are interesting. And I guess the thing that kind of bothers me about the show is that 90% of the victims in the show or the suspects are African-American young men. And normally how it goes, these African-American men are caught in crimes, you know, and normally they're crimes that sentence them to a life in prison. And so what Brother Beauty was saying, and sometimes as you begin to interrogate these young men, they have such a hard shell. First of all, when most of us are guilty, even as children, the first thing we do is say, hey, it wasn't me. We've all been to that point where we've been guilty of something. Our parents ask us, did you do it? No. I'm not going to use this example. I had a funny example of Dax. He did me this week, but he'll probably get me. You want me to share that little story? He said, okay, it's funny, but I can't share it. It's funny, but he might be embarrassed, so I'm not going to embarrass him. But anyway, the one thing that I did notice, the common line that I did notice, when these young men were being interviewed, they would always put a female figure or a male. They would use special techniques to get the victim, the suspect, to confess to the crime. And oftentimes what they would begin to do is they would begin to hold these young men's hand, and then they would begin to affirm these young men and say, hey man, you've had it hard. You really didn't mean this, did you? It was just a simple mistake. You was out there, you got mad, and as they begin to affirm these young men, what you begin to see is these young men used to, they begin to cry, they begin to break down. And then at first they were like, man, I don't know what you're talking about. Then they start sobbing. Then they're like, yeah, I did it. But one after the other, they're incarcerated. I'm looking at their ages, anywhere from 19, 20, 21, 22. 90% of the suspects on this show are African-American men. Then I begin to think about our society. I begin to think about our church. I begin to think about our community. And the reason why that we have such high absenteeism in the home, high absenteeism in the church, is because of the thing that Brother Beauty was alluding to, is that oftentimes these men are never shown love. They've never told that I love you or I appreciate you. And I remember one guy said the reason why he was in the gang and talking to gang members personally, the reason why they join gangs is because they feel like they're a part. They feel like I'm accepted, I'm beloved, I'm welcome. And so as fathers today, one thing that we want to do is to understand our importance. And even if we're a father and our sons are grown up, our children, our daughters, wherever they may be, we still have a chance to do something different. In Proverbs, it says that a wise son makes a glad father, but a foolish son is a heaviness to his mother. Also in Proverbs, it says that if you train up a child in the way that he or she should go, when they're older, they won't what? They won't depart. And sometimes as children, sometimes as men, we all get off track sometimes. Amen? Okay, yes. We all get off track. But what the scripture is saying is we have those deposits. And today, since we're talking about fathers, we want to understand, and we want you all to understand that those deposits, see, let me make this clear. Your children will remember very little of what you say. I know I've had conversations with my parents. I've had conversations with my sons. And I know that as I get older and as I'm gone and, you know, dad has gone on to glory and they're having their families, that they probably will remember very little of what I say. But how many of you know that your kids will remember what you do? When they don't remember what you say, they will remember what you do. Things I will remember about my father, I remember not a lot. Even a lot of times he says his messages, how great they are. You also, too, probably, he could preach for 1 hour, but you probably will remember one thing from his speaking. But you will remember how he treated you. You will remember how he did things in the ministry. For me, one thing that, or several things that I remember my dad being an early riser. I remember him, he's always gotten up early. And so as a result, I pattern myself after it too. I'm up 4:30, 5 o'clock in the morning. I remember my dad being very nice and generous to my mother. Now, whether good or bad, now one thing I remember, my dad was not a big flower giver to my to my mother. And my mom said, no, he wasn't. But, and as a result, I've kind of patterned myself. I give my wife flowers too, but I'm not a big, big flower giver. But my dad always made sure that the house was clean and his schedule was a little bit more flex. Even though he was doing ministry duties and he had the flexibility in which my mom was working an 8-5 job, she didn't have the flexibility. So oftentimes he made sure that the house was clean. We had a dinner. We had things that we needed. And so as a byproduct, I've kind of done some of the same things. Now, there were some things that I've done different than my dad did when I was growing up. So what am I trying to say? I'm glad that you asked that question. Let me get to the point. It is so important as fathers to be an example to your children because they will remember very little of what you say, but they will always remember the things that you did. So it's important for us to be a great example. Now I want you all to give these fathers a great hand as they take their seats.